All right, we're live again. Waiting for a few people to come on, but that's life. We have a new topic list. This is, I think, the first Saturday stream in a pretty long while, I think.
Yes, it's very. It was a long time since the beginning of
Tell me long
time.
time ago.
I made a few notes from goddammit.
Right.
Goddammit.
Yeah, lower the volume.
Yeah. Sorry about that. There we go. I made a few notes and because I watched I think almost the whole stream of Nurgle, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah,
Yeah.
he's a good guy.
Yeah, he's a good guy. I didn't say he was a bad guy. Just a few notes which I thought were curious during that stream. Here we go. When Gamediviner claimed that he talks to everyone, but during this whole stupid drama, he never.
Talk to you.
No, not me, Jen. Talk to, let's see, why didn't he put this idea out on Twitter in the public, or just KIA or GG Revolt or anything like that? That's kind of my issue with him. And calls Ralph an SJW and said if. Yeah, that's what he did.
Yeah, I know. He did that.
I'm just going through my notes because I had notes for 1 hour, I think, because we went through the first part last time.
And
And
I can tell you why he also called he possibly called others SJWs too.
if moderates leave the hashtag would radicalize and lynch Ralph, for example, they would destroy. This is his quote: "They would destroy you." And is this another quote? Is this the person you want to be like how Gigi is right now? When Oliver Campbell came in, I can't remember. I think it was a 45-minute mark or 50-minute mark. And he said he agreed with what Gamediviner was trying to do, but then backpedaled. And then it goes on to agree basically with everything what SJWs have said, that we should just leave the tag and because it has I'm paraphrasing, because it has too much baggage and stuff like that. That's exactly what the SJWs want us to do. And it's not like that I'm just singling out Gamediviner. I've just been hearing this a lot from a lot of people, which is stupid to me. And Campbell went on to agree with everything, and Milo and Allison Tiemann are both disagreed with this. They both said. It's also kind of rich that Oliver Campbell said and mentioned airplay, even though he didn't go.
He did.
Yeah, but he didn't want to go on the panel. That's what I meant.
Yeah, he left because of some issues that he had with
Well, he had a meltdown with Koretsky and
Yeah, I
then,
know.
didn't go on the panel, but then still showed up anyway and then, did all that talking in the outside thing during the evacuation, so.
And let's see. This is paraphrasing again. We're reaching a point where we should evolve into a new step, according to Oliver Campbell, which is basically a new hashtag or something. He mentioned like something like the SRB or some organization.
Yes, I'd like to mention the organization that me and some other third-party trolls were actually going to do. It was called Gamersault.
Well, I haven't followed that. He said that this was his biggest problem, and in the end, after 1 hour of this, he finally said, "No, it's a bad idea." But that's after everyone basically disagreed with Gamediviner for so he contradicts himself, which I think is kind of silly, but yeah. And just because of these two, but because there are many people who think the same way. I'm just using two examples of people who kind of agree with this sort of thinking, who have some sort of following. So.
Okay.
Well, I don't know what you guys think of this.
Well, I watched that whole stream myself. There was some points that I agree with Gamediviner on, and there were some points that, the issue that I noticed was when Ralph came in, Ralph went off on Gamediviner like it was nothing. Like, he basically just went off on him for no apparent reason. And to me, it kind of looked like it was disingenuous.
Yeah, it seems to me as well. But we have to remember, not one person in here or in GG can end Gamergate. It kind of dissolves itself. And for him, just even trying to think of something like this is very, very stupid.
This was kind of the issue. What happened to Mark Kern? A lot of people were like, "Oh, you're misgendering Sarah." That was the issue that happened against Mark Kern, because the fact that he basically said, "I will not call her that. I will not call her as what he would refer to her."
Well,
from my understanding, a lot of people just went off all political correctness on Mark Kern, and that's what happened.
The thing is, also from my perspective, is that a lot of people are currently struggling with what is Gamergate, what it is about, what we should we do, and let's just clear the following thing up: is that Gamergate got started and got big and got good at what it does because of the same thing, and that is not caring. We don't give a fuck. We only want these assholes that are against games and that are unethical out of the media. This is like the number one prime objective, and a lot of people are getting sidetracked these days, and that's what happened to Mark, and that's apparently what happened to Gamediviner and to Rolf and a lot of people. A lot of people are trying to get these secondary issues in, like the SJW thing. And while I'm not saying is we shouldn't also get rid of the SJWs because they are the source of corruption, ending corruption first is the most immediate goal. Because
let me finish this one first, please.
When we make it impossible for them to be corrupt, they are trying to do the same thing that they are doing and justifying it. And when they are justifying it, they just seem more silly. Just like with Sarah Nyberg, when they are trying to justify pedophilia, they look really, really silly. They only have one option: to kick her out of the clique.
But they didn't.
Yes, they didn't. And now they look silly. Now they look like fucking cockheads.
Yeah, the problem is, though, we have those ethics people who are only going ethics, and can't see that SJWs and the ethics kind of go hand in hand.
Yes.
I do agree with you. We should focus maybe a little bit more on ethics, but we don't. The source of all this is our feminists and SJWs, who are the root of the problem, and we can't ignore this.
But they're making it seep into common culture, into common thinking. That's their goal, to make it a part of common culture. That's the goal of postmodernism in general. But this entire, oh, you're just an SJW, I've fallen victim to it myself. It just needs to stop, because we're trying to purify ourselves. We are incredibly accepting. I mean, the biggest miracle of Gamergate was that it got Reddit and 4chan together in one boat as allies. Hell, even Tumblr joined it at some point. Some of Tumblr.
Yeah, there was that was a big operation. We tried to convince the public about this issue.
Yes, and we have people from Pole, I mean, okay, most of Pole is now GG Revolt, but we had people of Pole working together with furries and LGBT people, and I never thought I would see the day.
Yeah, and it's true.
Yeah, the fact that we were surprised that even of all places we had like what's his name, Ben Garrison, talking to 8chan instead of 4chan.
Oh, I didn't catch that.
He likes 8chan. He doesn't like 4chan because he doesn't like Moot.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but even 8chan is kind of dying down now, except for the V board and a bit of the pole board. Most boards have fallen really, really deep.
Yeah, most of them are, but there's also the other boards I will not say.
Yeah.
Well, we can kind of. That's all I really wanted to cover.
I don't hear anything.
I think you cut out.
Yeah, I think it's the connection, because lately Google Hangouts have been fucking up lately. Yeah, this is kind of a really big issue. It's okay, man. We understand.
I just wanted to move topics. Because we pretty much covered this. It's because I didn't watch the whole thing last time. I kind of just wanted to finish this point. Let me just mark it. So.
All right. Okay.
Well, the next topic is kind of personal, because I was at a lecture. Concerning our organization structure and culture, and it seemed a little bit biased because it was a female who had the lecture, and said that feminine traits make people similar, while masculine make people different. And made it seem like masculine traits are really hostile towards people, and that I had a big issue with.
What was the institute or the faculty that was holding the lecture?
I think I don't know what faculty it's part of. It's an economics faculty, at least.
Okay, but was it an actual economic professor, or was it a member of another faculty? The faculty is kind of like the where the.
No, I think I think she was a part of it, but she's been kind of in and out and been doing other stuff, so she's not really been a regular in the faculty.
Because a lot of colleges and universities have kind of like quotas. Where courses need to get other faculty members on, like cross subject stuff. And as I can tell you, the moment that you start going into postmodernism a bit, you will meet these people. It's nothing that you can really do anything against. Postmodernism, it's stretching everywhere, and sociology in itself is like a plague.
Yeah, and she also brought the point that that females kind of had it hard, and I thought it was stupid because everything else about the lecture was pretty informal, and I got to learn a lot, but that kind of irked me a lot. I kind of wanted to stand up and say. That's bullshit.
Better than standing up for any student, better than standing up and saying that's bullshit is find a question that would make them prove their point. Because that's just what they can't do. If if they are really members of postmodernism, they can't prove their point. Ask them for data, ask them for studies, ask them for cross-references, ask them for empirical points that make this possible, and most importantly of all, ask them what would disprove this.
Yeah, because and also ask them if they have done any experimentation on this.
I mean, actual experimentation, not handing out a few worksheets about how a certain thing makes people feel, because that's what they do. They just hand out worksheets and ask, how does this make you feel? It makes me feel uncomfortable. Leading questions are the biggest friend of sociology majors.
It just really irked me, because there was nothing else that never really bothered me with any sort of lectures, but this stuck out in my mind, and this was on Thursday.
Yeah, you could also ask him, what are your credentials?
Yeah, I could have done that as well.
Yeah, research the credentials of this person and ask, well, what is your background, particularly?
Mine. I have to do that because it's
best thing ever. There's a school of I've actually written a bit of an article about this. Not really an article, a tweet longer. About how sociology is a purely top-down science on a purely top-down issue. And the best way to counter these is to ask whether there is any finding in psychology or in behavioral studies or in neurology that support these things. Because what sociology does, and a lot of sociology people also like to get into economics and political sciences, they look at stuff, and then they look for a pattern, and then they, of course, find a pattern that resonates well with their political worldview, and then they say, well, this causes that. What they don't do is they go to people who actually, you know, research human behavior and look for a reason.
Yeah, why, like, for example, psychology.
Yes.
Psychology.
I mean, there's Richard Kahneman, who's a psychologist, and he got a Nobel Prize in economics for his research. And he wrote a book called Thinking Fast and Thinking Slow. What it is mostly about is how we make decisions. And the really most interesting part about this is that it explains so much, and it checks out with most other research into decision making and rationality and perception, because it just lines up so well, even with neurosciences.
I have the lecture in front of me. And even put up sexes as one of the three demographies. I don't know how it's said in English.
Demographics.
Demographics. Sorry. It's education, profession, sex, and generation. Which this female put up, which is true, but when she talked about the subject, she was really biased, and what I said earlier, so. Yeah, we can move on to the next topic.
And I can say hello at this point.
Hello, shitlord.
Indeed.
I finally decided to let him free from my channel, and I just kind of followed him here.
Indeed. We just watched the South Park episode, for anyone who's interested. Yep. That one that you've seen all over funny. Twitter. So.
Yeah, that shit was funny.
All right, the next topic is Leigh Alexander, being the unethical journalist she is.
I can't believe it.
Can somebody screenshot? Because somehow I've been having problems.
Give me a second. I shall sort that out with my superior internet.
You might have this.
Do do do
Yeah, Leigh Alexander is, I can't believe she's being, you know, unethical. She did hire Sarah Butts after all.
Yeah, it's what's her name, Anna Entropy or whatever. She didn't disclose her relationship to her again. And what a big surprise! And she was also, I don't know if you watched the documentary on gaming, Deus Ex. It was
that
on
was that game. Was it Game Over? Or was that one
Game Horizon or something? It was on the BBC on Wednesday.
Oh, no, I haven't watched the GTA one. I haven't watched that yet, but I'm, it's on my list.
We were talking about it outside, though.
Yeah,
no,
well...
It's not the movie. It's a documentary.
Right, something else. I'll get some usage.
Yeah, I can ask for the Space Kitty, our Scottish male. A friend, he can probably give you the link.
Yep, fine. Shall we get through this shit?
Yeah.
We'll sort that out later.
Yeah, it's pretty. But the point was, Leigh Alexander is also in there listed as a game journal, which is kind of hilarious. Seeing how she does this shit, watching her on the screen all the fucking time. Yeah, go ahead, Desex.
Just wondering if there are any particular parts of this you wanted to highlight. I mean, there's obviously the red underline here. I've here for $2. Support on Patreon, of course. It's always Patreon. Always Patreon.
Yeah, we can. Anna Entropy has written for Offworld. That should have been. Yeah, at least she disclosed that.
She is a game developer, too.
Yeah, what children's books can learn from games. My Nintendo savvy. Trendsetter was scary for her, and what kinds of features help make game tools more accessible. With a little help from what's WarioWare DIY, you can buy Oh My God, Are You All Right Here for $2 and support your ongoing works on Patreon here. Jesus Christ.
What the fuck is this? What children's books can learn from games? What the fuck does that even mean? I don't know.
What?
Okay. I don't know.
Yeah, but this is basically a big ad for this woman.
Oh my god. Are you all right? It sounds fucking funny to me. I don't know.
Can you read the tweets? Because I think they're a little bit too small.
I shall start from the top and continue to the bottom.
Wait a second. Can I get a quick clarifier here? Because I think I've heard the name Anna Entropy before.
Yeah.
And that person in the profile picture of that Twitter conversation does not look like that Anna Entropy at all. I remember her looking like a 35-year-old dude who just put on.
Oh, hey, Davis, your dog is here.
Yeah, Anna is actually transgender.
Yeah, I googled her. It's her. It's the Anna. Oh god. She put this up as her profile pic. Oh, she most likely herself put this up as her picture in Wikipedia because she's on Wikipedia apparently for some reason. And it's seriously, she looks like a male comedian trying to do a thing with a wig.
Yeah. Well, just read the tweets and we can go through.
Very well. I shall begin. Children, are we all sitting down? We're ready to read a story. Here we go.
Yes.
URL, Wizard of Vor, blah, blah, blah. At some points, while I wasn't paying attention, Oh My God, Are You Right? Sold its 100th copy. Thanks. And down we go.
It's now
which
time.
Coming, Leigh Alexander. Coming, so I ordered food from a different place, and then immediately the first guy showed up. I don't even know if I can make it for 7 tonight because of key situation. But feel like I won't be gravely missed or anything. I'll miss you, Leigh. Flowers materialize around my head, signifying illumination. That's not flowers signifying. What the fuck? I will see you tomorrow, and maybe later I'll see.
talking about drinking again? No.
Any idea where dinner's going to be on Thursday? Oh, I just thought it'd be nice to get together. Email. We can meet somewhere near you, or I could show you around my area.
Yeah.
Disclosure, zero. Friendship dates back to 2010. Archive link, blah, blah, blah. Why do people... Can someone explain to me why people discuss this kind of shit? Not DMs or something? Or I don't get it.
I know. I mean, whenever you and I are playing something, we're usually on DMs for hours discussing it before it ever becomes a thing.
Because they're massive attention whores.
Indeed. But we've got one favorite. I assume that was from Auntie Pixel, Auntie. Weird.
Yeah,
anyway.
You can stop presenting now.
Very well. You can stop presenting me first. Stop it first.
So,
otherwise, you'll get the fucking feedback. Otherwise, there we go.
We had triggered a few days, and I actually triggered a few people in my stream by showing actual, you know, game cases. So, to any SJW seeing that, if that wasn't triggering enough, then here you go. Here's a little bit more triggering for you.
Mortal Kombat.
Yeah, I'm looking at some of our games. Some of them are.
What a real game looks like.
Yeah.
I would just like to point out that you guys remember the AGG guy, right?
Yeah.
Helicopter?
I would bet my ass off that he would deny that there is any friendship going on here.
Yeah, he would.
And... To be fair, I might actually be... he actually wants to debate me again, so I'm talking to him about that. I'll bring it up.
Bring up blame the Jews argument with him. That the other side's trying to do. He'll get upset.
Yeah, I listened to the whole 8 hours.
It's so sad. When you are so out of ideas, you start stealing jokes from Encyclopedia Dramatica. I mean, a long-running joke, and I've been seeing this joke in their communities for years now, is the Jews did WTC. So
we're not even using that one anymore.
That joke predated ED.
The standard joke now is that jet fuel can melt steel beams. They are so far behind.
Grandpa. That was one of their articles of the now,
I actually proven that that jet fuel does melt steel beams in spaceships.
In spaceships, sure.
And that's a reference. That's a reference to Independence Day.
Oh my god! Oh my god! Okay, that is a movie. If there's one deleted scene, if they had left it there, the whole thing, the whole ending would have made so much more sense. I mean, it shows him actually using that Mac to hack into the spaceship. It doesn't just come right the hell out of nowhere. It's actually explained. Good job cutting that out. Now you just made everyone confused.
What I like about the 9/11 truthers is they usually, I mean, they even hang around here in Germany, and what I really like, they come with this document and say, wow, here are the names of 2,000 architects who said that the World Trade Center shouldn't have collapsed, and every time they come with that, because I live in a city where the activists are really aggressive about their flyer shit, I'm like, well, that's really nice and dandy, 2,000 architects. Come back to me if you ever actually have construction engineers instead of designers.
Yeah.
Because architects have no idea about what structural integrity even means. They probably looked that up on the internet.
It's kind of like the whole thing with Rihanna. We were saying that Samus is transgendered because of one joke made by a background designer.
Yes.
I mean, everybody knows if you want to build a tower that can touch the face of God, then all you need is a Bronze Age society putting rocks on top of each other. It's in the Bible, people. Come on. That's how we get different languages.
That knows more about the Bible than a lot of Christians do.
Yeah, that says a lot, actually.
Oh, Jesus.
I mean, there's Martin Luther, and he printed the Bible in foreign languages, so people could read the Bible, and now 500 years later, people are still not reading the Bible.
Heresy. But he is a heretic. We can't listen to it. Come on, you could only read it in the original Latin.
No, actually, in the original Hebrew.
No, it's look. Do you not understand? It was originally written in Latin. That's how God speaks. Just ask the Catholic Church. They all know.
No. King James Bible is the literally word of God. That's what these people keep telling us. The King James Bible. They spoke actually. God English. Speaks in English, in King James English.
In medieval English, yes.
During the Tower of Babel, he dropped the Bible down in English and said, "Can't read it? Tough shit."
Anyway.
The Bible's actually in Klingon, done, thread.
Oh my God! No,
yes,
actually,
you've got to read it in the original Klingon. Just like Shakespeare, you must read it in the original Klingon.
No.
It loses all meaning otherwise.
I actually think that God speaks in Esperanto, and you actually have to learn to speak Esperanto. The Esperanto people should form a church just to get people to learn the fucking language.
I think they're the ones behind the flying spaghetti monster. Either that or this little guy here was.
No, the flying spaghetti monster Bible has actually been written in Italian. That's absolutely clear.
Oh my God.
Well, let's move on to the next topic before we go completely off rails. The next topic is you wanted to talk about Leo Pirate, and then some others have been getting suspended from Twitter lately.
Wait, what?
Yeah, Leo Pirate was suspended. Yeah.
By Izzy. By
Izzy Galvez.
I'm not surprised. Oh, heaven forbid, he quoted you. He posted a picture of a tweet that you yourself made defending a pedophile. Heaven fucking forbid.
Have you actually looked up the most prominent voices in the entire pedophile protection ring? They all wrote articles defending pedophilia. I mean, I think Ben Kashira also posted an article. What was it? Horse semen tastes like hay and other stuff.
It was actually on a forum.
Yeah, it was a forum. He said pedophile is no moral wrong. Yeah.
Okay,
technical forum, I think.
If any of you sick fucks are watching, you can't have my dog, okay?
I already have two dogs. They're enough trouble.
No, this one tends to show up. If I'm in a call or something with James, this one will show up almost every time.
Dogs like your voice. I mean, if you don't want dogs to show up, don't start talking.
That would be boring to me, though. If he's going to be in one of my streams, I actually want him to say something.
Is there something like with cats where you can just put a box next to your computer?
No. Well, if I let any cat in here, this one would probably get beaten up because he'd run over wanting to play and he'd get his face scratched open. So I'd rather not try that. And there he goes. See you later, Raji. I have no idea.
Hello, doggy.
He
actually got on there so that he could talk about ethics in the afternoon walk.
Well, back on topic, guys. The whole Leo Pirate thing.
Well, it's bullshit, yes. Obviously.
Leo actually predicted this in his video. He said if his channel or this video gets taken down, he's posting the material for everyone to download, which is really the only way to prevent this kind of censorship, because you know everybody has it. Nero has it. Nero or Milo was working off with the stuff that he downloaded himself. He didn't listen to the video
I got it too. Well, I don't have the fourth leak that was posted out a few nights ago, but here's the thing though, and I kind of mentioned this too, and I asked Leo if I could do this the day after he posted it. Guys, mirror Leo's video. I know I'm doing it. My friend Charming Man, who is an upcoming YouTuber, he's got a copy and he said he will mirror it if need be. I know at least four other Gamergaters on YouTube that are mirroring it. We need as many of these out as we can. They're trying to shut it up. They're trying to basically make it look like we're just attacking poor little Sarah for being a trans, and that's not the case. So guys, you know, mirror that shit.
Big surprise.
Yeah. It's funny that we're the only guys being censored here, that Gamergate is being censored and not being covered at all.
I'm not at all surprised about this. I mean, yeah. Here's the thing, and we discussed this on another stream. If Sarah was pro-Gamergate and this came out, we wouldn't be able to escape it. It would be all over the fucking place. But because of the fact that she is anti, of course her buddies aren't talking about it. And if they do, then it's a, and this still makes me sick to know it, it's a sexual orientation and we're just fucking ready for it.
Well, as I said, they're great at moving the goalposts. There is no way the public in general is going to sympathise with this shit. So I don't know what they're fucking thinking. They're fucking mental.
Now I need a painkiller, man. So.
Here's the thing: they think that just because HCHAN is a hate group, they're going to say, "Oh, that's because Sarah is a victim to them." That's what they're going to point out, that she's a victim to... and that was it.
Actually, I'm glad you mentioned butts, because in the last stream, James, you saw this too. Someone that was there actually shared this really interesting Photoshop from the South Park episode. Hang on. That's not it. There you go. Someone actually who can mimic the style pretty well took out Jared Fogle's face and put butts in there. Enjoy.
That's great.
I laughed hysterically when I first saw that, because the guy had been telling me about it in the chat, and he created a Twitter account just to get that to me. Thank you, dude. You have no idea how much I appreciate that.
Well, yeah, Lisa has a point here. If this had been someone, remember the whole thing with Tom Sawyer with the whole guessing thing. Can you remember the game? We got a lot of shit just for that.
And I mean, here's the thing, though. You know.
Here's another thing. Right now, they're also accusing Andrew Simpson of being a serial scammer.
Wow.
Andrew Simpson. Who's Andrew Simpson?
Who? He's. I think he's the one that did that one Kickstarter for that website that he was planning to do to teach code.
Oh, okay. That thing.
Yeah, they're saying that he's a scammer, and I'm like, what? Yeah, someone's pointing out that he's a scammer.
Wow, it's almost like, ignore the pedophile we have, they have a scammer.
No, our scammer, we have a scammer.
I know, that's what I'm talking about.
Oh no.
Yeah, but they still have Anita Sarkeesian.
Exactly.
Sorry, she just...
They still have plenty of scammers on their side.
Well, this is a situation, right? You think there aren't going to be people who are going to take advantage of a situation that draws so many people? I mean, come on, let's be real. This is the fucking real world we're living in here. Let's not. We're all fucking aware that people are not all fucking honest about their fucking intentions, right? Of course they're going to be fucking people out taking advantage. Of course there are. Let's not be naive about this shit.
I mean, we saw Brianna Wu do it after the whole thing with 4chan, and she was trying to use a woman's murder that had nothing to do with us or 8chan in general, and trying to say, oh, you know, Gamergate, you're saying I shouldn't be afraid? Of course, there are going to be people that are taking advantage of whatever negative thing happens, no matter how horrific it is.
What the people are currently doing, especially the people who have articles or write articles, is that they're doing something that you could describe as negative search engine optimization. Normally in search engine optimization, you paraphrase a paragraph, paraphrase an article so that when you Google a certain theme, a certain subject, this will pop up as high as possible. And what they're trying to do is they try to name drop Gamergate and MRAs. They actually did the same with MRAs before Gamergate did. What they're trying is to name drop them in articles so that these articles pop up early when people Google Gamergate. they rely on people being stupid and using Google, or generally just using standard search engines, which you shouldn't do for obvious reasons. And this is actually the reason why they're doing this. And I don't think there's some kind of malevolence behind it. Of course, they think Gamergate is evil, and they are wrong about it, and they are trying to push a narrative. But the reason why they doesn't belong is because they want it to pop up. They want to make Gamergate become a scarlet letter. Give a link to your Twitter channel in your resume or something like that, and you favorited a tweet about Gamergate, and your employer-to-be Googles Gamergate and finds this article, bam, livelihood ruined. That's how it works. They want it to be a scarlet letter. And the best way to something to be a scarlet letter is to search engine optimize it in the right or wrong way, depending on where you stand.
I just realized I've never spoken to you before, so hello. My boyfriend says you look almost identical to his cousin.
No. We're nose friends.
I don't know what he means by that.
Share the same nose. Seriously.
Well, Kamasin, or Singh, oh, I don't know how you pronounce that, actually said that I look exactly like a former classmate when we met in Birmingham.
Well, I mean, like I was saying, I just realized I had never said hi or whatever before, so hello, how's it going?
That's no problem. I never said hi either.
well, I just, like I said earlier, I just kind of don't like to use Singh here, so...
Keep your stupid comments in your pocket.
I don't have pockets, motherfucker. I'm wearing a skirt.
Prove it. Big story didn't happen.
Wow.
Yeah, well, I noticed that Yahoo is still allowing 8chan to be available for searches.
Yeah, because Yahoo is absolutely inconsequential.
Well, not only that, I mean, if whatever is true, a couple of Antis have had, you know, either have friends with Google or have held positions with Google. So the fact that they're being listened to over the general public doesn't surprise me.
Well, it just shows you how far up the ladder all of this goes, really.
Yep.
Yeah, they're willing to cover up the issues.
Honestly, Google. After seeing all the shit with ABC and MSNBC, this doesn't surprise me anymore.
Yeah, but MSNBC, they actually have the people creating the content. Google is not really a content creator in the journalistic or media sense. But we more or less have a confirmation that Google has an SJW PR manager or something like that. When they posted this Gamergate tweet and it got removed and they had to apologize, I'm pretty sure there's some guy sitting in PR who's keeping the finger on something.
Well, for one thing, of course, this is Silicon Valley. They're always getting, you don't have enough women in tech, blah, 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 all that sort of stuff. The other thing is corporations in general don't want to offend anyone because then you might not have people buying your shit. It's really at the end of the day, it's self-preservation. That's what PR is about.
Yeah, social justice warriors are the concerned moms of today.
Yeah, I mean it's the irony, of course, which is these people are not really a consumer. You don't know who your consumers are, really, but it's like there could be a potential consumer. Therefore, you can't offend anyone, and this is the situation you get in. Unless you're someone like Protein World, and it's like, well, if you're determined to be a fatty who's unfit, it's like you're probably not going to be one of our customers. So fuck you.
Yes.
That sort of thing. Right, but otherwise,
that's why I like small companies, small government, small businesses, because they can actually afford to not give a fuck. I mean, look at CD Projekt Red. They just don't give a fuck. Yeah, lesbian sex, full frontal nudity, collectible sex cards. They don't give a fuck.
Same with Running with Scissors with Postal too. I mean, they explicitly said that they were not objecting to being on the BlockBot because their customers were on the BlockBot. And I mean, A stream regular of mine actually gave me Postal 2 a couple of months ago, and I played it through, and it's in my top 5 favorite games of all time. And I happened to tweet that out, and they saw it and thanked me and said, hey, you know, if you have any ideas for future games, let us know. I mean, they actually give a shit about the people that buy their stuff. And and I'm pretty sure I could say most gamers, even if you're not a fan of Postal in and of itself, just that kind of worth ethic, I think most of us agree with.
It's because you actually know who your audience is. Because you can afford to know your audience, and because your audience is small enough to have a common theme. And that common theme goes along your product. If you're so incredibly big that everyone uses your product, you will not be able to get a clear line. It's a sad reality. If you want to have more money, you got to widen your audience or be able to overprice your product. Most companies these days do both.
Yeah, and the sad part is there are certain developers that just shit on the customers so badly that they blame the customers.
Than developers.
Yeah.
More publishers than developers.
Yeah. And the funny thing is that they shit on the because one of the developers that created a game specifically, you might remember, you might have heard of this game. It was called, I forgot what that name, the game was called. It was called Sunset.
Yes.
And they were tweeting, the developers were tweeting this out saying that they were blaming us, the gamers, for not buying their game. And it's like, I looked at that game, looked at the storyline and everything. And I was like, okay, this is a black game.
It's about cleaning your house and talking about books that you find. It's technically hip. It's hipster monologue. It's hipster monologue. The game.
Yeah,
it's like I told them. Look, it's a cleaning simulator. If I wanted to clean a house, I would just go clean my own.
Yeah, but the funny thing is, it was stereotyping the black maid. It was perpetuating the black maid thing. Basically, you have a black woman cleaning up the house.
I wouldn't read that much into it. I wouldn't read that much into it, because they surely didn't. How Broteam puts it perfectly is that this game is so pretentious, it gives you an art school degree.
Hey, don't diss art school students.
Yeah, and I think they were trying to create the artistic style of the game, but it's like they focus more on the art style than the freaking storyline.
Because these developers aren't gamers. Gamers realize that the most important part of the game is the gameplay, just like the most important part of the movie is the moving pictures, like the most important part of a radio play is people talking. It's the one thing that sets it apart from other mediums, and these people are trying to remove gameplay and call it a narrative-driven game.
Because gamers totally care about the storyline. That's why Minecraft is so big.
If you like that, that's not a problem. If you want to basically have an interactive story, it's not like that shit hasn't been around for forever, right? It's not really a problem to me. But if you're going to then claim, right, well, this is the only way things can be, it's like, well, fuck off. I like a wide variety of shit. It's like if all movies had to be summer blockbusters, right, and you couldn't have any little independent art house shit or whatever, crazy fucking Dutch shit or something like that, I don't know.
The funniest thing is we see the same trend in AAA games, just there it's not narrative-driven games, there it's called cinematic games. And Yahtzee put this the best. A game trying to be more like a movie in order to be cinematic is like a man trying to stick his head into a pond in order to be more like a newt. Or a movie consisting only of text slides in order to be more like a book.
Yeah.
If you want to make a game, make a game. Don't try to sell it as a game when it isn't. And this is why the developers that support Gamergate, even from anonymity, are gamers, because they make games and they want to make games. I mean, have you ever seen how it is to work as a game developer in the industry? It's not good. People who stay there either have no other marketable skills, which I seriously doubt, or they really love making games. So when the people in the media say gamers are bad, they're insulting the game developers as well. And then the publishers come along and say, well, we are also against Gamergate and toxic masculinity. And now imagine what it's like working under a publisher that hates your culture and have to keep your mouth shut because you might lose your job.
I don't know. To me, it sounds like these guys need a fucking union, like the Writers Guild or some shit
yes,
like that.
But the ICTA was supposed to be that union, and look what they did now. The ICTA claims itself to be a union for indie game developers, and they kicked out all the people. This happens with a lot of unions. They try to politicize. They try to become one as a political union, and that's just not the way it goes. Unions should be primarily about economics, not politics.
Yeah, but obviously the history of unions is very socialist, but by the inherent nature of, like, basically we want better rights for the workers, the common man. But yeah, the real point should always be, are you actually improving a lot of workers or not?
Yes.
And everything else is secondary.
I would like to share this. It has to do with kind of the same thing, but we kind of talked about this earlier.
The whole NeoGAF thing? Yeah, I saw that.
No. The whole Izzy thing. If we compare Gamergate versus Anti-Gamergate and see compare. Let's just see Izzy Galvez. He, as we see, like we talked about earlier, talking about how he suspended Leo Pirates. That's great, Izzy. Nice to know, it's a witch hunt. Now you're not friends with actual pedo. Wait a second. What's this I see? Is the archive. Wait, what's verp.org? Oh, that's verp.org. So,
wait a second. Didn't Mark Chernovich post this already?
I can't remember who posted this.
Yeah, I've seen it from a couple of people. I'm pretty sure. Mark,
well, we have people like Sarah Butts, and we have Izzy here who's having conversations with people who. Who are I don't know if they're a pedophile, but it seems to be a pedophile.
interesting anecdote. When I can give from politics here is that Germany is a representative democracy, so we can kind of like vote more than just two different parties here. And from time to time, it happens that a political party. A third, so to say, although it's not the third political party, we still call them the third, gets in because they're currently popular. And one of those parties was the Greens. And the Greens were very economically aware. And after they have been voted into the parliament and got their first seats, flyers started to circulate. And these flyers promoted feminism, they promoted gay rights, and they also promoted pedophilia, or the decriminalization of pedophilia. It's always the same. They get their foot in the door, and then they start pushing their shit.
I noticed a few left, more, you know, radical left-wingers doing something very similar here in the States. It's like, oh, it's just a sexual orientation.
Yes.
No. I'm sorry. As someone who is part of the LGBT community, I find that personally to be a huge insult to the phrase sexual orientation. I'm sorry, that is disgusting to me, just because, and I mentioned this before, for a lot of LGBT, we have been, especially here in the South, I live in Georgia, we've been trying to stop the idea that, and I've heard this before, actually, if we allow LGBT, we're going to have to allow pedophilia. And for so many years, me and so many others before me have said, no, that's not the case, you know.
Have you ever seen Russian media? Have you ever seen Russian media? Because the Russian media kind of uses the same thing. They say, oh, look, the West, they're so homosexual, and the next thing after homosexuality is pedophilia. And then you're going to be forced to be homosexual. It's the exact same thing.
Well, the Russian Orthodox Church is pretty powerful in Russia, which is pretty much
The thing, though, is that, and this is what angers me,
you know, we've been having to try to say this for decades. And now that we have, you know, now that gay marriage is legal in all 50 states here in the U.S., now we have this going on. And this completely takes all of the years of hard work we've been putting into to put people's minds at ease about this kind of thing, and it's proving the radical right-wingers right.
Yeah, because for years I have been told that the slippery slope argument is a fallacy, and I am now trying to, you know, kind of like work this out, because to me it's not no longer a fallacy. It's an empirical fact. The slippery slope seems to be an empirical fact. Stop proving fallacies right. You're just making it worse for yourself, because if the next thing that gets legalized on the same basis as homosexual marriage is pedophilia, you know nobody will listen to you anymore. You can't go for pedophilia unless you severely enact thought control. This is like, this is the last place where you go. This is the absolute last place where you go. You might as well just start shooting people. You might actually get bored by just shooting people instead of promoting pedophilia. It's not going to work. Seriously. You're not going to get any support with this. You don't have the demographic for it.
Well, if you take a look at the thing I'm screen sharing, I found this on KIA, and NeoGaf actually defending Sarah Nyberg, even though if you read this post I posted, like it or not, Nyberg herself proved the logs were real, that with that story on Medium, trying to play it off as teenage edginess isn't a valid defense. As for Mali, he claimed to have called the cousin's parents and the police. Whether he did or not is another story. If a Gamergate was accused of pedophilia, this discussion would be so forgiving. And what happened? You have been banned for the following reason. It's clear from your posting that you are not good fit for the new GAF community. Junior bans are permanent. The ban will be lifted. Never.
Fuck you, full criminal.
No, this
a
doesn't surprise me at
all.
The
NeoGaf community. What's a good fit for the NeoGaf community?
Hang on, James, how long have I been calling NeoGaf pedogaf? As long as you and I have known each other. There's a reason for that. They've been doing this shit for years. I'm not the least bit surprised.
Even Ralph said that they were defending pedophilia. And I hate trying to reference Ralph in this whole thing, but he mentioned that there was a board that they were mentioning defending pedophilia, and it's like,
they were
wow.
Before Gamergate was even a thing, before anyone had before the conspiracy or any of that shit happened, they've been doing this for years.
They actually tested the water with this entire anti-gamer, anti-consumer message with the, what was it, Mass Effect 3. Ending controversy when they said, "Oh, gamers are entitled," and that's where I first noticed that the media might not have the gamer's best intention in mind. And they actually had prepared the "Gamers Are Dead" article for a way, 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 way longer time. They actually were prepared to have this seep into the media over a course of several weeks. But they felt like their hands were forced, and they released it all in a day. They really tried to play the long game, but Gamergate forced them to act quickly and irrational, and that's
which
why we
honestly
got them
just
at the
made
balls
us question
today.
Things even more.
Yeah we got them by the balls.
Fucking idiots. I don't know how to do any of this shit properly. That's why they lose in the end, because they're not very good at what they're doing.
If they were good at what they're doing, they wouldn't be doing it in video games. Seriously, these are the college dropouts of social justice warriors.
They are literally college dropouts, so they never did anything fucking useful in college to begin with. So, anyway.
They're the college dropouts of college dropouts. Yeah, I dropped out of third year physics. Yeah, okay, you can actually do something.
I dropped out of gender studies.
And they call it education.
If gender studies is too difficult for you, maybe you should just go back to preschool. Oh, wait, no, don't do that, considering who the bunch you guys are friends with. Never mind, ignore that. I'm sorry, I shouldn't have said that. I'm sorry, no.
I think they're already trying to get into preschool, given
what I'm trying to do.
Yeah. Or get a general college.
Next time you're in Georgia, remind me to slap you for that one.
Or just get a general college degree.
I was more referring to the concept of safe spaces and having fucking ball pits and shit like that.
Fair enough, well, but still, I still owe you a slap.
We should allow safe spaces because then they'll shit on everything in safe spaces.
Dude, okay, I mentioned this before. When Nostalgia Critic is bringing up that the fact that you guys seem to be offended by Jerry fucking Seinfeld, who Disney has made edgier jokes than him in the past few years, when he's too offensive for you, something is seriously fucking wrong.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I'd like to point out there is a preschool for adults, by the way.
Is it called SAWs?
What the fuck?
No.
Yeah, don't they have, like, Play-Doh and stuff? And don't you have to pay, like, $10,000 per year?
I always thought what? Preschool for adults were just bars.
The fuck?
Holy shit, it's been a while since I've seen someone make him facepalm, so this is a good moment for me. Let me enjoy this for a second.
I don't want to live on this planet anymore.
Alright. Do you know who Andrew Simpson is, Lisa?
I've heard the name.
He's the guy from CodeUSA.com.
Just press the link.
Hang on a sec. I'm just reading the chat.
Chat, assholes.
Right. I will say every now and then.
Adults, and it was kind of like Burning Man minus all the drugs and sand. So yeah, there we go.
Hang on. What question do you? Hang on. Time must ask you something.
Now, doesn't me and that gentleman have
oh,
twin
noses? Oh, for fuck's sake, this again?
Totally have twin noses.
He's asking you because you've actually met us before.
See my nose.
Oh my god, Ty, seriously, drop it.
It's uncanny, I'm sorry. It's like it could be related.
Yeah, this
hang on, let's go ahead and kill this right now. Hang on, come here. Come here. Let's kill this.
We have no.
What's happening?
This article that was just posted. I mean, what the heck? Preschool Mastermind is a month-long program that seeks to reconnect grown-ups with their inner child. But living in your basement with your parents and watching children's cartoons is somehow wrong.
Hang on. There is now a literal preschool for adults.
Yeah, this is fucking. This is amazing.
Literally, honey, look.
What the fuck is this woman wearing? What the fuck is going on?
Oh my god.
Wait a minute. You guys haven't heard about this shit? This was discussed 2 years ago. They actually promoted this shit 2 years ago somewhere else.
Well,
two
I was happy
ago,
to.
I was happy. Therapy.
I was happy to wallow in my ignorance, to be fair, truthful.
Two years ago, I was in therapy trying to fix whatever.
Keep in mind, this was before SJWs became an issue. This was before this whole shitstorm started. So somebody actually wrote an article about it and basically mocked it. And now it's become serious, apparently.
To be fair, certain groups have been dealing with SJWs for years. I know I'm probably going to get some shit for this, but the growing community has been dealing with them ever since the whole therapy fiasco. So,
yeah, well,
I mean...
Well, I have a problem with brownies, and I'm not an SJW.
I'm actually a Pegasus sister, so I guess you have a problem with me, too.
No.
Did you say brownie or brony?
He said brownie. It's a long-running joke.
Okay.
Sarge is here!
Hello.
How's it going, Sarge?
Hello.
You should address him by his proper title. He earned that, Lieutenant.
Wait a minute. Deus Ex, I thought you said Lieutenant in the UK.
Oh, God.
I don't understand what the fuck you're talking about.
You might have been drunk, hon.
Well, we can, since Sarge has joined us, we can move on to the next topic, which
keep
is
yay,
which is the thing I've actually put forward now with Gamespot for them not disclosing that they intended a review event, and maybe even being paid to come out there for reviewing the Metal Gear Solid 5. I put the link in the description or in the chat as well.
KIA link.
Yeah.
Well, didn't Konami have this MGS 5 boot camp thing where
that's my point. They were monitored by the Konami staff and had a certain
But here's the thing. Here's the thing with that. That was criticized by a lot of people. I mean, a lot of people actually.
That's good. But my point is, why isn't this disclosed in the review? That's my issue.
Yeah, but because everybody, I think that there was a list, I think, of all the different outlets that actually went to the boot camp, and I hate that term, but anyways, they went to the Konami thing and they play the game, and I don't know, didn't they write an article about them attending it? So.
Yeah, there was someone who went in there, but shouldn't the publications who actually went to the review and disclose this in the review?
Yeah, but here's my question. This is the review, right? You're talking about the review for the actual game. That's what you're talking about here, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Here's the difference. If he got the game. After he has, let's see, he got the game and he played through the game from start to finish and then wrote a review, then honestly, him being at the boot camp doesn't matter.
Hey, can we bring QQ in here?
Yeah, we can.
Also, someone in the chat just said Andrea Alvarello's article just dropped. I don't know what they mean by that, but that was in the YouTube chat.
Yeah, no, but we're going to talk about that.
I was reading Varela's article before coming on here, so it just. It's interesting.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know.
Can you post the link, please? I kind of like to glance it over.
Well, back to the Norwegian guy. I still think it should be disclosed because it's not a regular review, and we don't know if they actually finished the game.
Well, here's the thing, though. I mean, I'm just asking questions here, and the one thing that. Because I haven't read the review. You have, so I'm gonna ask you this. The reviewer who wrote the actual review for the game, was he one of the people who attended the boot camp?
Yeah.
Okay. So because here's what I understand from the boot camp thing. The boot camp thing actually included them being able to play the game for a significant amount of time, but. None of them actually got to finish the game. I don't think anybody really finished the game in that time.
There were a few, but not all of them finished the game. So it's uncertain if this person actually finished the game.
So your problem with this review is the disclosure thing, and that's a perfectly valid argument. But couldn't you make the argument that didn't GameSpot wrote an article, right, about them attending? Didn't they do that?
No.
Isn't it a very well-known fact that they were one of the outlets that were attending?
You can't bank on well-known facts. I mean, we are pushing the people to disclose their friendships, although the friendships are right there on Twitter. You have to disclose it. Sorry, I even think you should disclose review copies just to make the list complete.
Yeah, that's perfectly fair. I agree with that one.
And the boot camp is just like traveling to somewhere else to get the review copy. I mean, sorry, but getting a review copy is way less of an issue than traveling to a special event and playing the game, which many reviewers do. I mean, do you remember the pre-release thing of PlayStation 4 where everybody freaked out because Sony made the people travel to New York to play the PlayStation 4?
I have a more recent example before the Metal Gear thing, actually. Another game that is actually The Witcher 3, the guys at CD Projekt Red did the same thing. They invited a bunch of people to Poland to actually play the game.
Oh, didn't know that.
I didn't know that.
You didn't know that?
They invited...
I didn't either, but I'm a dirty American.
You didn't know that? I mean, Angry Joe was there talking about it. He was one of the guys that was invited, but he actually said
Who pays attention to Angry Joe anymore?
No,
I think Jesse and Dodger also went to that as well.
Yeah, they did. Jesse and Dodger were there, and And but here's the thing: they disclosed it, and Total Biscuit actually refused to actually talk about the Witcher 3 because he had some affiliations with the CD Projekt Red guys, and that was fair enough. I mean, he disclosed it, so he didn't do that. Actually, he actually was very a little worried about actually having to talk about the Witcher 3 thing because he didn't. He felt that he had too much of a connection to the CD Projekt guys.
That's totally fine. But yeah. If that also happened to The Witcher 3, that's another big issue.
Well, it happened, and a lot of people know that it happened because the guys at CD Projekt Red they advertised it pretty heavily, and it was a very well known fact. Anybody who has listened to Total Biscuit's podcast about it are aware of it because at least 350,000 people. To that podcast, know that Jesse and Dodger went there, and everybody who listened to Angry Joe's video because he was there. And the only reason I know that Joe was there because I haven't seen much of him lately, but I saw his reaction video to the Star Wars trailer, and he basically said, "Hi, we're in Poland for a Witcher 3 event," and that was before the game released. So I reckon it had something to do with the. I reckon it was the same event. So this is not just the big AAA devs. You know, we have CD Projekt Red is one of the developers that did do this as well. This is not news. I mean, I think most people are aware of this. But that goes back to a point I made earlier on one of your streams, Andrea Dahl. We're not really paying that much attention to gaming industry outside of Gamergate.
Yeah, and I do remember that. Angry Joe did a video, and he went to the offices of Project Red.
That was a big event.
Yeah, but we know if...
And he actually did an interview with the developers.
Yeah, but do we know if it was just YouTubers or if it was...
it was a YouTube video.
Yeah, because it seemed to me that it wasn't the journalists who went there.
Well, he was the luckiest one of all, that's for sure.
Yeah, he actually I know he was there, but it didn't seem to me like it was it was journalists going there. But back to my point, which is that Metal Gear Solid is in the review. It should be disclosed. And the game review came out on the embargo, so it was impossible for them to get a review or a copy before the review. So... They basically reviewed the game after they went to this review boot camp, so to speak.
And that's sort of a bit sinister review boot camp to me.
I still don't get why people support review embargoes. They're incredibly hypocritical. I can kind of understand it with cinemas because a lot of people like make their weekend free to play to go to the cinema, and you know you got to make a decision. But a review embargo with games, it's just something different, and I think it's incredibly dishonest. I remember I think it was even Robert Kotick talking about demos and why he's not offering demos to any of the game that EA publishes, not EA, Activision. And he said that demos hurt the sales numbers, and I just thought, well,
can I just mention one thing about that? Because there was a huge discussion on review embargoes and the fact that even companies, because this was a big discussion in the gaming press last year and before Gamergate started, and has been ever since. And it started out essentially with. Gaming companies refusing to send early review copies, because publishers refused to have an embargo. They wanted to release the review as soon as possible, while the gaming companies didn't want them to do that. And a lot of times, it turns out that the games that had an embargo turned out to be total shit. And I want to mention an article that I read. I'm trying to find this article, but it was an article that a bunch of Q&A testers had essentially said that a lot of upcoming games are really in bad shape. And these are Q&A testers who are testing some really big titles on their way. Battlefront was mentioned, Fallout 4 was mentioned. A lot of upcoming games are really bugged.
said Fallout 4, my heart dropped.
Yeah, I was going to say Fallout 3 is pretty bad on the PC. I cringe to think what Fallout 4 is going to be like.
There's a few mods you can get that actually make it playable. I mean, I have them, and I've enjoyed the game much more.
The reason for this is that the AAA industry has hit that point where they just aggressively market any piece of shit, and people will buy it. I mean, Just look at all the advertisement for shit like that. Just look at how aggressively they market things. Just look at how much they push pre-order bonuses and seasons passes. They don't need to make good games anymore. I mean, look at the Transformers movies. The AAA industry is currently at...
Well, it also has a lot to do with, because, you know, it also has to do with, I mean... The AAA keeps getting away with all of this shit. It's because most people are fucking idiots and buy shit no matter what.
Yeah, true. But I would also like to point out, just go quick before you go go on. Last year, the AC Unity embargo was 12 hours after the game was out, and it was buggy as shit.
Yeah.
That's kind of curious as well.
I think but that game was horrible on every platform. I mean,
PC, yeah, true.
It was just. PC
got it worse. But man, I mean, I played it on the PS4, and I had one of those, one of those invisible, where you basically run on the map and you fall through this hole and you keep falling. That happened the first 5 minutes on the PS4.
Look, it's not a bug with the game. It's just a realistic portrayal of a bug in the Animus, okay?
Yeah, sure it is. Or shady development.
Why haven't they said that? That's what I... See, I should be in PR. I can come up with this bullshit.
Yeah, well, when it comes... it's really not that hard to disclose. As I said, I don't know if GameSpot or the other publications paid for going out there themselves, but it should be disclosed that they went to a review camp, a review boot camp, and had a limited time with the game. This should be pointed out in the review.
That's the whole point. Presumably,
here's the thing. I got a question. Did they have to jump through hoops just to get that room?
Review copy, yes.
Rings of Fire.
Well, keep in mind, when it comes to Solid in particular, I mean, when it comes to Konami and the relationship they have with the press, it's not been a good one. And when it's ironic that we're talking about this when it comes to a Konami game of all games, because Konami has been a company that has treated the press like crap. They basically been real dicks when it comes to actually talking about their games, because they have no fucking idea how to publish a game even. So it's really interesting that we're talking about Konami pulling off all the strings to promote this game when they didn't seem to give two shits earlier.
Konami seems to have made an incredible turn in the recent months, with more or less murdering all their profitable franchises. I mean, they're just committing PR suicide with their all-time fans right now, but they're at the same time aggressively marketing their shit. I mean, it's like they saw, look, all these companies are doing really, really shitty stuff with their customers. Let's do it too.
Here's the thing with Konami. Here's the thing that really separates from any other gaming developer out there. Konami is not just a gaming developer. They sell bottled water in Japan. And they have I'm not kidding. They have their own bottled water they sell in Japan. It's a huge company. The gaming division is just part of it. It's just a small part of it.
Actually not that bad.
They can shut down their entire gaming division and still make it as a company. They are pulling out from gaming, but they will still survive as a company because they're not dependent 100% on gaming, because they do all they have. Gambling machines in Japan. They have the pachinko machines, those machines are incredibly popular in Japan, and it's a big market for them, and they earn a lot of money. That company if they basically get rid of the entire gaming division, which it looks like they're doing right now, since they ceased production on any AAA title except for Pro Evolution Soccer. It's not going to matter. Konami will still go on. as their own company. They don't give a fuck about gaming. That's fine. That's their decision.
Why don't they just sell their intellectual properties? I mean, they would sell for so much dosh.
I will say, I have there's a little Japanese grocery near here, and I have tried some of the bottled water that you're talking about. It's actually pretty good.
Yeah. I don't know if it's called Konami. I have no idea what it's called, the bottled water they're selling, but I have no idea what it's called. Yeah.
Konami water, the only choice when you're playing Konami games.
Or used to play Konami games.
The only way you can get the bottled water is to pull the lever.
Yeah. Well, we can laugh at this all we want, but it's a market we don't understand, and it's not a Western thing. It's a Japanese thing. You know, pachinko machines is a very, very Japanese thing. And yeah, I mean, we can make fun out of it, but, you know, it's really popular over there, and it makes them money.
it's a great way to get a cheap pack of cigarettes, if anything, because, I mean, you can turn in your... You could turn in your winnings and actually get, like, a pack of cigarettes for them, so...
This is unrelated, but I just found in the Facebook group a screenshot, or maybe it's just a mock-up of a game called Backstreet Abortionist.
We have that Kill Off X game or whatever, this doesn't surprise me.
It's you have the tools Gin, Coat Hanger, and Vacuum Cleaner.
Did you just say vacuum cleaner in a game about abortion?
Yes, as a tool.
What? Wow.
You know what I'm talking about.
You know, I think you just made my uterus crunch up because it just started hurting.
Wow.
It even has that Oregon Trail graphics style.
Oh, okay. I'm going to regret this, but I kind of want to see it now. Is it kind of like a Custer's Revenge? Remember that piece of shit from like 20 years ago?
Yeah.
The very first game.
The Atari game.
Yeah.
That's more like 30 years ago now.
Shut up, you.
I know. Yeah, he's right.
I'm about to turn. I'm going to be turning 30 next year. I don't want to think about that.
Well, 20 years ago.
Well, it is available. It is available on emulator.
I haven't seen it.
20 years ago was a year before Quake was released, so it'll give you some context.
I know it's on an emulator. I actually debated with doing a playthrough of it just for shits and giggles.
It's not a story-based game, you know that, right?
Who cares?
Okay, what, I think I just derailed the entire thing.
What, you think just because I'm a girl I want story in my games? Misogynist motherfucker?
Well, back to the topic. Back to the topic, which is yes. Metal Gear Solid 5. And is it unreasonable for me to ask for the disclosure of this thing?
No, not at all.
It's not. But at the same time, considering all your battles with GameSpot, Andrea Dahl, I'm thinking that they are actually starting not to care anymore what you say, because you really pissed them off lately.
Yeah. Here's the other thing that bothered me about this is that they failed to mention Yu-Gi-Oh! Being released on PS4.
What?
Yeah, I will say this, Andre, you have my utmost respect, because if I were in your position and dealing with them for so long, I would have raged. I would have just full-on raged and tried to purposely get myself banned. So the fact that you haven't lost your shit with them, I have so much respect for you because of that shit.
Well, I pointed out mods going rampant and all that stuff. I should have been a mod myself, but for some reason I'm not.
Yeah.
So.
I understand that you guys are having issues. I even read some of the stuff that the stuff that this guy said. Like this guy was making the same stupid excuses. I don't want to watch this video. It's taking so long. Bitch, if you had time, watch the video.
Then again, yeah. I mean, we are talking about the people who can't. Some of the same people who can't be bothered to play a game all the way through before writing a review of it. So
yeah, and the guy was like getting upset that he doesn't want to watch a video or a live stream of people talking.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
this is, and that moderator was actually talking to people on Gamer Gazi. And even they followed up on the some people were like following this guy.
Yeah, and he's really active on Gazi.
Yeah.
Jesus.
Yeah. And he was speaking, the one deleting all my threads. So.
Yeah, and it's
sad. I hate my threads.
Yeah, there's also the fact that I was kind of pissed off that Konami didn't bother to market Yu-Gi-Oh! Legacy of the Duelist game.
Gotta catch them all.
Okay, first off, that was part of Pokemon. Second off, you already did your one singing of a Japanese theme today, and I'm so horrified.
I know what it is.
Yeah.
You tried to serenade me earlier with the Pokemon logo, or the Pokemon theme song, and I'm still triggered by that, you shitlord.
It's sad, too, because that game, you know, they said that is going to be available on the PS4. And they didn't bother to, you know, they didn't give a shit about it.
And that's the sad thing. I may not be a huge fan of the Yu-Gi-Oh! Anime, but I've always thought the games were at least pretty good. I wish I had known about this. I would have gotten it myself because I have a PS4. I actually do enjoy the Yu-Gi-Oh! Games, so I mean, I would have wanted to know about that.
They actually have it available for demo.
Can I ask you guys an opinion on something? When Lisa mentioned the PS4, I just suddenly was reminded of some news that came out of TGS.
Okay.
How many is willing to pay? I mean, they Sony just announced that the Project Morpheus classes will cost the same as the entire console system. How many is willing to pay?
$400?
No. They didn't specify a price. They just said it will cost. Basically the same thing as a full gaming system.
Well, okay, are they talking... Now, here's the thing, though. Very recently, like in the past week in Japan, the price for the PS4 has dropped dramatically.
Yeah.
So are we talking about how much a PS4 would cost here in the States or in Japan, or what?
Well, okay,
according to Andrew House, it's $400.
No.
That's approximately $400.
Yeah. Okay, there are so many more things that I could actually get that I would actually use with PS4. I need to get a new tablet.
The question
if I had that money, I'd be getting a new tablet.
The question is, what's the option? I mean, for PlayStation 4 players, none, because they locked them into their stupid, crappy economy. But what are the other game VR headsets like? They cost like $250, $300.
Yeah.
But aren't most of them development kits still? I mean, the Oculus...
No, I don't think so. I know the one that PewDiePie has been using, from what I understand, has been out for a while.
Oculus claims that they want to push it down to $200 for the consumer version.
Well, but yeah, because, I mean, how many people want to buy one now that PewDiePie's used it?
What kind of display does the Morpheus use? What other exact Sony actually produces very high quality displays, and I don't think that the Oculus Rift is using them.
I think that Sony was talking about using OLCD, the same thing that was originally on the Vita, the original Vita.
Okay.
So they're going to use some really. It was very. I mean, Sony is very good with the display thing, but I honestly, if they come out and they're going to sell this thing for $400. I don't know.
No, if they use something like OLED or AMOLED
OLED.
I would have said $400. If they're using OLED, that is actually an appropriate price, because OLED is really, really good. And Oculus wants to use an ISP display.
Yeah, but the interesting thing is that they are actually banking a lot of stuff on this, because when the Vita came out, it had an OLED screen, but it was incredibly expensive to reduce, and they lost a shit ton of money on that thing. And then they started making the cheaper version of the Vita that had a regular LCD screen on it, and I hope they're not falling into a trap here, because here's what they were saying, that during 2016, they would release 10 games for the Project Morpheus classes. within a year. It would be 10 games would be released for it. I'm not. Is that enough to hold the interest? Is that worth?
There is two different types of prototypes that they're making for the Sony Morpheus. And I remember they basically built several prototypes, and I wonder which one are they going to use.
Well, I know it got a small mention at the Sony E3 panel. I remember it got a small mention, but they didn't really give too much on it. They mentioned it was happening and that they're still working on it. That was about it.
Yeah, because I looked at, they have like several different models. I remember Sony released a specific model that was originally for PC, and you could actually watch movies on it and everything. Yeah, and this was in Japan.
But didn't they initially say that the only thing you would actually be able to play on the Morpheus would be PlayStation 2 games?
No.
No, I don't remember that. No.
They said they are going to bring out, like, for example, I believe one
God
specific
War. I know God of War was amongst them. The original first one.
Yeah.
Well, there's an update version anyway. You can get Sega pack. I've got that one. You got the original.
I believe that they're also trying to do. Let me see. Well, this is an indie game title, I believe, and it's called
Gone Home.
Not Gone Home. Gone Home.
You just triggered me, motherfucker, for mentioning that piece of shit.
You played it.
Well,
I have, and it was sad because about an hour in, my boyfriend just kind of looks over at my screen and goes, "You've been playing that for like an hour." I'm like, "Yeah." Is anything gonna actually, you know, happen? Fuck if I know. 30 minutes later, I just gave up and closed it down and played some Fallout 3.
Well, okay. Going back to the Morpheus thing, it was like one of the titles that I've seen, that I've seen have been titles like The Deep. You know, it's essentially the demo that's been shown a lot of times where you're basically lowered into a shark cage or whatever into the water.
Yeah, I've seen that.
That demo has been shown a lot. And then there was this demo that Capcom showed off that everody is talking about.
Yeah, I heard about that too.
Nobody has seen, and everybody say it's shit European scary.
Yeah, I think they had to write under a non-disclosure or an NDA, so they can't really talk about it. All people know is people thought it was great, and that's about it.
What are you talking about? PT?
No.
It's a VR game. Everybody is
talking
about. But
I don't think that VR might actually have the possibility to take off. It might exist, and it might be a thing that continues on existing, but it won't take off.
Yeah, personally, I think it's a gimmick.
We currently have VR games.
I believe that for the smartphone. There's also a VR game called Strike Suit Infinity. That's the one game that they actually released on the PS4, and I believe they're going to probably.
I have that on Steam. I played it like an hour.
You can actually play. I think the other version of Strike Suit.
Strike Suit Zero.
Yeah, Strike Suit Zero, which you can actually play on VR on Steam too.
Well, I remember there was I remember the PC. There was some fucking glasses you get and had some drivers. Apparently, you could pretty much any FPS you could do with these things, because obviously you just render two different scenes, which is fairly easy to do if you've got if you're running a 3D engine, obviously. But pretty much every other time VR has been done, people get motion sickness and shit. And every other time, it's certainly been a gimmick. You've got, like, starting off with your 3D glasses in the 50s.
I would challenge anyone doing Mirror's Edge with VR.
Oh, God. Imagine that with Valve that in Project Morpheus. You'll
Valve would freaking love to do that, to be honest.
Well, it's going to be... Well, here's the thing. I'm not gonna judge it yet. I want to try these things first. And there's an event in Sweden in a couple of months where they will have the Project Morpheus glasses available. And I am considering heading down there and giving them a try. And if I can get my hands on them, I would I'm probably going to be talking about. I'm going to test them out and see what I think about it. I'm curious because I have no idea how this is going to work. I may get a headache from it because I suffer from migraines. So I have no idea how I personally will react to it. And like you said, motion sickness is a problem. I mean, they had this issue even with the 3DS where people got headaches for playing too long with the 3DO.
It's quite simple. Yeah. I mean, the reason is because your eyes are giving different information to the rest of your senses. So probably, since people are talking about the Matrix in the chat, you're probably going to have to get jacked in with a fucking plug in the back of your head or some shit for that.
There have been a few talks about this. For example, Valve talked about how you can take away control of the camera or the player will get more...
Just let me get this one.
For example, when you have a death screen and the corpse is like flying away, you can't do that. You can't do that. And another research team recently found out you can actually reduce headaches and motion sicknesses in VR if you give the player a virtual nose. Because apparently being able to see the nose on the bottom of your own field of view is kind of reassuring to the brain.
NG, you're choppy and people have been complaining about this. Turn your fucking camera off. Get some bandwidth.
Okay. Also, by the way, do you see Mint Ghost in the show? Get it right.
What? I wasn't...
Ghost in the Shell, you mentioned the Matrix. It was,
Get your Weebo shit out of there.
Yeah, they still have Ghost in the Shell.
Okay, fine. Now, what I was going to say, now there's other problems with VR, which is it's not just stereoscopic. You build a 3D sort of model in your brain, not just based on stereoscopic, but there's also monoscopic cues. So eye movements, subtle movements of your head to judge certain things. So that's what it'll always be flawed by that mechanism because it's not the sole way your brain constructs a 3D model.
But here's the thing. When it comes to all the work, I mean, like you said, this has been a problem with VR or 3D glasses for a long time. And looking at how long it has taken the guys at Sony to work this out, I mean, they had the Sony guys, they know what they're doing when it comes to these kind of things. My question is, how will it actually work? I mean, there are two screens, obviously, in the Morpheus, but I still am a little optimistic because people who have tried it, they like it a lot, and I'm cautiously optimistic to try this. I'm really just cautiously optimistic.
Does it track eye movements?
Yeah.
There are some systems which can technically inherently track eye movements. There is a system called the Glyph. And it's not fully VR capable because it doesn't have the field of view, but what it more or less does, it shines a white LED onto a set of prisms, of tiny rotating prisms, and these rotating prisms reflect the right wavelength of light into your eyes. So it's technically like a beamer beaming directly into your eyes. There's no real screen. And they are technically capable they're also technically capable of doing VR for people who have, for example, two eyes that don't align with each other. So if you have like a lazy eye or what you call it.
Yeah, I've got astigmatism. I've got one of those in my left eye. So
you can actually do very easy real
really?
VR with that.
That's what that is. I thought you were just drunk.
Fuck you.
I remember going to a museum called Robert Ripley's Believe It or Not in Orlando. They had this exhibit where they had this thing called the Vortex Tunnel, where it basically has spinning lights riding around and you're on a platform just going to it. And, of course, you get really dizzy trying to, you know, figure out where you're standing. And sometimes you would probably fall or just go, whoa, whoa, because you're off balance.
Well,
it tricks
exactly.
Your mind. It tricks your mind to believing that everything's out of place.
Yeah, because things like your inner ear aren't going to be synced up to what your vision's seeing. Things like that.
You were saying eyes in two different directions, and I immediately thought of her.
Well, because it's things like you get... That's the reason why when this shit was coming out in the 90s, when they had the sort of first massive fucking things, and yeah, I played one of that. This is why people would get motion sickness. It's that, like, seasickness. Your motion isn't lining up to what you're seeing.
Yeah.
So you get, your brain gets confused, and then it goes, fuck this shit.
Yeah. Also, kind of the topic, which is with GameSpot, the, there's a private board I'm on, and I mentioned, because somebody talked about Metal Gear Solid, and I said, guys, calm the fuck down, the game isn't out yet. This was when the reviews were coming out, and it was before the game, anyone could buy it, and I saw people just freaking out about the scores, and I said, people, calm the fuck down. It's somebody else's opinion. You should wait before you actually see some gameplay or actually buy the game yourself. Okay. And what?
Go ahead. Continue. Oh, I'm
yeah.
Sorry.
And basically, it went back and forth, and these guys basically went... went 3-on-1 versus me, and can't understand basic ethical problems. These guys also former on GameSpot, because there was an upgrade to the GameSpot page, and everything got fucked up. And it now turned out that I wanted to have one of these guys on stream, or the three of them guys on stream, but of course they bitched out. So.
Yeah, I'm gonna show you guys something here.
Oh, sorry.
There's
I can,
like several. I'm gonna show you that. Yeah, go ahead.
So
I want to show you something on the screen here. These are the several models that they were going for with Sony, with the VR headsets. They have like several VR headsets, like this one, for example.
Yeah, they also have home cinema. Yeah. That I think that's the home cinema one.
Yeah,
there's like, different.
And a lot of people joked around that it would be possibly that model, but instead we get this model right here.
Did you get redirected right now? This X.
Yeah.
And it's like. I kind of see it, but it's also what they're trying to do here is that you can see that they're using the controller. You can imagine what they're going to do with it.
You know, if those glasses had red lights on them instead of blue, you would look like a fucking Cylon from Battlestar Galactica.
Yeah, it's like I can see what they were trying to do here. Like you can imagine them just like throw like. Sword fighting with the blue ball controller, which I actually call it the blue ball controller.
It's a lawsuit waiting to happen, is what it is.
Yeah, but the question is, did that blue ball controller vibrate?
Oh! Wow.
Yeah, you can imagine somebody, like, just playing with your girlfriend with that thing, and you'll be like, what the fuck? And it's like, you know, there's like several models that they have made for Sony.
2016 is going to be one hell of a weird year, isn't it?
Yeah.
I can't wait for the sex bots. Not because I want to get one, but because I want to see everyone's reaction to them. And we're already getting some price.
Japanese hentai game developers are in full swing already. They're getting ready.
this is like their gold rush. This is like their economic power years.
Yeah, I wish Sony would use this.
Just wait 3 years and you will be able to get loop at the checkout of a grocery market.
Wow.
GameStop offering Project Morpheus now with free lube.
Well, yes. back.
Or better, you know how they since touchscreens became really really popular, they used they sell these touchscreen cleaning wipes, which are technically just the wipes from the wet wipes for glasses. I bet they're gonna sell kind of like wet wipes for cleaning out the silicone hole. Like a huge Q-tip or something that you just get in there in order to clean it all out.
Well, this conversation took an interesting turn. Thank you, Mr. Thank you. And if, of course, it had to be a German who went there, didn't it?
Well, my point of the last topic I took up was because these people seem like they are very anti GG people, and every time I even tried to get anti Gamergaters on Wednesday, there was one who actually came on, but I posted in the against Gamergate Reddit page and. None of them actually contacted me and came on the stream. So it seems every time I want any aggros to come on, they refuse. That was kind of the point of this. And the circular logic, which I had, I don't know if you saw that Norwegian guy, the stream with AGG, the helicopter guy.
Oh, yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. I was trying to make a few points, but I've experienced this several times, and every time I've been trying to...
Andres, you do know that AGG is a confirmed troll, right?
Yeah, I know. I kind of noticed, but I got kind of angry when he interrupted me. Anyway, yeah.
A guy calls himself AGG Pro. He's the annoying little shit stain that came into Leon's stream and started spouting shit. It was a hell of a stream. It was 7 hours long. I think it was his longest stream ever.
No, it was.
And I was there.
Fuck, man! What a nightmare.
LT Sarge, I also had him recently. That's where I went on, and the thing is, we're with him, and go ahead.
You have to realize that guy's full of shit. Some of his claims is full of shit.
Yeah, I showed him proof, and when I show proof to these aggros, every time they just ignore it and move the goalpost, or I use a straw man.
Well, I gotta say, though, and I'm gonna do something that I rarely do, and that is defend John Kelly. He was on that stream with AGG Pro, and when I got exhausted from arguing with AGG Pro, he went straight in there, and he was fucking ready for this guy, and I was like, thank God, I'm going to bed. I was fucking exhausted.
Yeah, it's just a circular logic with these guys, and constantly goalposts moving. I don't know if you saw the GG stream 2 and 3. Because we had Kaz on, and he did the same fucking thing.
Yeah, but there was this guy is not. I don't really think he is a social justice warrior, because he is in this for the laughs. He's in this for the lulz, and that's what he's. I think he's a troll, because I don't think he actually believes anything he's saying, and he is just there to argue a topic to death, and using semantics. And if you misspeak to this guy, he will attack you relentlessly for an hour.
Can I recommend a book for you, or not a single book, but a topic of books? Just read up on Socrates and his Socratic methods and his fights with the sophists, because this is the exact same thing we're seeing today.
Yes.
We are having legitimate empirical methods of thinking and acquiring knowledge attacked by people who want to twist definitions and words. We are dealing with our times equivalent of the sophists. It's sophistry. They twist words. They in German there's a term called drilling, or making a rope out of something. If you make a rope out of something, that means that you like want to hang someone for something trivial. If you misspeak, if you use the wrong word, they are gonna drag this out, and they're gonna turn it into a rope, and they're gonna hang you by that rope. And this is what these people love to do.
I want to share something. One interesting thing that I heard is that I had a friend of mine who recently finished law school, and I am thinking about studying law when I'm done with my studies at when I'm done with my pre-exam courses, which I'm doing now. And he told me something interesting. He used to be one of those politically correct people, and after becoming a lawyer, he basically said, I am so glad I started studying law because it has made me very distrustful of words.
Yes.
And it's because he noticed now, and he now realizes how crazy these people are. And he said, whenever you hear these people talk about social justice, read between the lines at every single thing they say. Be distrustful of every word that comes out of these people's mouths. And he, as a lawyer, has become very good at that because you have to be careful in what words you choose when you're dealing with legal issues and so on.
So, hang on. Oh, sorry.
No, go ahead.
Something interesting just happened. So I didn't order a pizza, but I just got this one from Little Caesars, and it actually had a note on it that said, Lisa, SVU will be taken off Netflix. Time to celebrate. AR. Acid is best waifu. I've been telling you guys this for months. Thanks for the pizza.
Acid Rain.
All hail Acid Rain.
Real misogynist five women pizza, apparently.
By the way, has anybody seen the South Park episode?
Yes! And James did a reaction of that on my channel earlier today. That shit was really funny.
I need to watch the episode and do a reaction on Wednesday or something.
I'll send you the link to the OneDrive that I have that has it on there. That's what me and James watched earlier.
It is hilarious.
Is there any topic you guys want to talk about before we close the stream? Not the South Park. We're gonna go do that next time because I haven't watched it.
Here's the thing. SVU actually, all joking aside, SVU really is being taken down off of Netflix. Seasons 1-12, which are gonna be taken down, and it's no longer gonna be updated. I don't know where it's moving to, but I can verify that SVU is being taken down.
Hulu.
You poor motherfuckers at Hulu. You're just trying to be relevant, aren't you?
Hulu has it. They actually have some of the episodes.
You know, the weirdest thing about these entire talks about Netflix and Hulu and stuff like this is 50% of the stuff I don't get here over in Germany, and even if I did, I wouldn't get it because I really, really don't like media streaming.
I still buy
DVDs and CDs. I really don't like media streaming. Because of shit like that. Imagine if you were an SVU fan and only had Netflix, and suddenly you have to get something else as well.
Andrea, I had one topic that I think you're pretty familiar with.
Yeah, go ahead.
The blocking of Pirate Bay and Popcorn Time in Norway.
Oh man, that I totally forgot. I wanted to talk about that. Yeah, for those who are not, because Norwegian guy, I mean, we live in Norway, of course. But
you don't say.
No, I live in Sweden.
There's a court that ruled that ISPs in Norway have to block. I think it was Pirate Bay and a few torrent sites.
CrimeWire as well.
Yeah.
Is Kick-Ass out of commission over there too?
Yeah, and here's the funny thing, though. They basically, I know a few of these politicians who actually came up with this law draft, and I actually have been speaking to them on mail about this. And I basically wrote to one of these guys and asked, "What the fuck are you doing?" I wrote it. Translated directly into Norwegian, what the hell were you guys thinking? And the reason is, and they were like, well, this guy I spoke to, I'm not going to mention his name, but the guy that I spoke to,
Doc Sim. I'm kidding.
No, the guy that I spoke to, he basically told me, well, it's going to take somebody with extensive knowledge to get past the block. No, that's the point. It takes simply all you have to do. You can download an extension on Google Chrome or Firefox, whatever fucking web browser you use, and then you can turn on the VPN function, and boom, you have access again. The people in the UK started doing this when the Tory pricks decided to block sites.
That was the whole point of, I mean, especially around the time of the Egyptian revolt. I mean, they had shut, the Egyptian government had completely shut down internet, and it was through VPNs that these people were able to get the truth about what was actually going on out.
And then we have the great firewall of China which people have been able to, people are getting information the same way, because the Chinese basically thought, okay, we have blocked these foreign sites and nobody can access them, but all you have to do is basically use a VPN. Boom, you're in.
Let's not forget about the Australians either. They're involved in this shit as well.
Yeah, VPN everything gets banned over there.
VPN is so fucking easy that my Windows phone has an option to select a VPN when I connect to a Wi-Fi network.
Getting back to what happened, I mean, the interesting thing, the people that I spoke to, everybody who works in IT in Norway is unionized, or most of them are unionized, and their union in Norway actually said, this is not going to make one difference at all, and you don't need to be a technical expert to make this work. Anybody who Googles how to get access, you can Google the question even. You know, okay.
Hell, there are Google Chrome extensions that'll let you do that.
Yeah,
proxy flow.
They were claiming on the news that it would take somebody with extensive knowledge in computers to get past the block, which is bullshit. And the ISPs, they are happy as fuck because now they're not liable for any legal shit.
I think that's probably the real point. The truth of the matter doesn't matter, if you forgive the use of matter twice. It's not the truth. It's not whether it's factually correct or not. It's the fact that the ISPs are gone. Thank fuck we're not legally liable anymore.
Yeah, that's the whole issue. And it's hilarious because the movie industry is so happy. They think they won this big victory, and it was like, no, you haven't. All you have made is actually managed to get the IST off the hook.
Yeah, but that support. It's like, this is the fucking thing with it. I'd be more than happy to fucking like pay for this shit. Like, stop with it. Like, okay, you're behind the fucking times. The internet is international. It's not going away. It's only going to accelerate, so fucking join the 21st century and just let anybody anywhere in the world pay for your shit.
That reminds me.
Well, I remember using it. Oh, go ahead.
Did you hear about what Zoe Quinn's planning to do?
No. Please, enlighten us.
She's going to the UN. She's going to the UN to talk about harassment. Internet culture of women being harassed on the internet.
Yeah, No, it's cyber violence. It's cyber violence.
Violence against women.
No, cyber violence. The first thing I thought, she's going there to give a how-to on how to do it.
Well, if she ever gets a proposal head, all we have to do is wait till the Russians to veto it.
That was one of the things I thought of as well. It's like, okay, what are you going to do? You're going to get Vladimir Putin to go, oh, right, that's right, I love the gays now. No, that's not going to fucking happen, is it?
Yeah, no. If it does, it will be a very strange day.
Yeah, she might as well bring up that lesbians will most likely be victims of cyber terrorism.
And I can imagine Putin going, well, this is fucking great. Let's roll with this.
Well, to quote Kim Kardashian on Twitter talking about Hillary, hashtag Hillary for persistent. that actually fucking exists.
There's one topic. I also wanted to link this with a story I had with a feminist in the kitchen, because that story got fucked up last time.
Oh, yes, that monstrosity. Oh, and Yeah,
for those who don't know what I'm talking about, basically I was at a party, and the feminist asked, well, are you a feminist? I said no, and he asked this girl, she said no, and why not? And he asked, well, aren't you for a equality for both sexes? And I'm like, yeah, then you're a feminist. I said, I'm not a fucking feminist. And he asked this girl, well, what do you think feminists are? And she said, they're crazy. And it basically went on to where I challenged him why if feminists are for equality, why are they protesting movies like 50 Shades of Grey? What the fuck is that doing?
No, well, it's I've got something. There's a tweet I just posted. There's a bit of mathematics you can do now because Jessica Valenti has said that the patriarchy is using equality to oppress women. So equality
Wait,
is.
I'm a chick. I'm not good at math.
Equality is oppression. Feminism is equality. Is oppression. Therefore, feminism is oppression. Do the maths, people.
Yeah, I always find it amusing. They're like, oh, we're.
The moment they start changing the definition of words in their favor, they have lost, because everyone then can change the meaning of words in their favor. This is why a dictionary is so fucking important. When somebody says, yeah, the dictionary definition of feminism is equality for both sexes, then just bring up the fact that most people who call themselves feminist activists are so incredibly against equality of sexes. Say that feminism can't be for men, or that even men can't be feminists.
The whole point of the Newspeak dictionary is to make thought crime impossible.
Well, the thing is, though, and I've heard this mentioned, just let me say this real quick. They keep saying, oh, we're all for equality of men and women, then why do you have such a huge issue with MRAs?
Well, yes. I just wanted to go back to the Zoe Quinn UN thing. I don't think we really have. I really don't think we have anything to worry about, because the UN.
No, it's just going to be pure comedy. I want to.
Yeah, but you know what's going to happen? You know what's going to happen? Zoe Quinn is going to wave the fact that she spoke at the UN around like fucking crazy, and the media is going to wave it around like fucking.
Yeah, but here's the thing.
Just another notch in her belt. She's just complained to a more important person, and in feminism, you are as important as the most important person that you complain to.
Well, someone brought this up in a stream last night. Here's the thing. She will be going to speak in front of the UN. Some of the countries that are, a part of the UN that will likely have representatives there are going to be serious or actually oppressed countries. She's going to be sitting there talking about, oh, I had to leave my house and I got to come to Paris. And a couple of the UN ambassadors from more impoverished countries are just going to look at her and go, bitch, say what?
I can just imagine some oil sheik from Saudi Arabia. You can come and stay in our country for a couple of weeks. We will teach you about oppression.
The other thing to remember is that he or she was a roaring success, and that's ended all oppression everywhere.
Yes, she actually shows that she's being oppressed while going to France.
I love how
the UN is incredibly effective at getting shit done. We all know this.
Yeah. I mean my point essentially for bringing this up is, let's say that they are actually going to do something about online harassment. Here, they couldn't even agree what to do in Syria situation, because they had two countries putting a veto ahead and nothing got done. And that's the same thing. Do you think these countries who are a member of the United Nations, I mean, she's speaking to an organization that has countries that are actively are oppressing women in them. So I just, I find this hilarious. It's such a, the UN is a relic from the 20th century that barely functions anymore.
on a side note here, when I talk to people, especially when I sometimes get, because I follow American libertarians, when I got sucked into dialogues about, you know, Israel and Gaza and stuff like that, many people seem to bring up the argument that the UN is somehow a tool controlled by the Muslims in order to eradicate the Jews.
If that's the case, they're not doing a hell of a good job.
They're a worse hate group than Gamergate. I think Andre et al. Wasn't done. I think we completely, cut him off.
Sorry about that, man.
Took
go
it
ahead.
In a completely different direction.
No, it was a good point. I just wanted to finish my point because it had to do kind of with what also Norwegian guy mentioned.
And I still have to reply for that when you're done.
The debate actually escalated where I with the 50 Shades of Grey, and I accused them of Puritanism, where feminists were here in my city. They were protesting the movie, and I said, "Well, why are they doing that?" And because it's problematic, because females shouldn't be dominant. And I said, "How the fuck would you know? Or maybe some females like to be dominated. It was written by a female, and females are buying this." And he pulled out the only card he could, rape, and he said that in Oslo, all women were afraid of going home. And I said, how the fuck do you know that? Because I know many women who said this to me. And I'm like, many women means you know every woman in Oslo feels this way. How can you even know? The crime isn't that high.
And, so all women are the same to this guy? That's sexist.
Yes. Especially many women to him are all women to everyone, apparently.
Well, here's
how many women
can
you know? Around 70 at max.
Here's the thing with Oslo. It's such a weird city because you have the western part of Oslo where all the hipsters live, where all the rich kids live. They live in a place where there's little crime, there's tons of police presence because all the rich people live there, and then you have the eastern parts of Oslo, which is incredibly not. That's where a lot of immigrants live, that's where all the diverse communities ironically lives. And here's the thing. A lot of these, there was this thing where there were a lot of rapes happening in Oslo, and every single woman has decided that she was a target. And it was like an entire month of showing women, oh, here's where you go if you need to teach yourself self-defense courses and stuff like that. It was nothing but rape on TV for an entire month. It was like, they called it an epidemic in Oslo.
Yeah, but the thing was, it was such a small percentage. And my point is that these feminists used his rape card, and in the end, he just left the conversation because I basically owned him. And
you want
just to show, just let me finish. You can discuss it. But just to prove that feminists are so unpopular in my city, this election, they got less than a percentage of the votes in my city. So they really are not that popular at all. So they got owned this election.
And
so
your mayor, by the way, a female mayor, was recently arrested for corruption.
Yes.
Dun dun.
Yes, my old party. I love my old party, by the way.
That's why we have Gamergate. Party.
Just remember, politicians are shit.
By the way, she's a member of the Norwegian Conservative Party. She's a David Cameron, Margaret Thatcher-ish kind of person.
You don't have proper conservatives in Europe. I'm sorry.
Yeah, here's the thing. It was something I kind of brought up last time. The whole thing that, women can't be in a nest kind of thing. Let me show you a little something. I've used this before. It's been used on me before. You want to say again women aren't into that kind of thing?
Are we going into another one of your dominatrix rants?
This was made for me. So,
to everybody listening, there will be a dominatrix stream with Lisa after this one. Stay tuned.
Okay, first off, a dominatrix is just someone that pays for that kind of thing. A domé is someone that does it, you know, because that's their lifestyle or what they like to do or whatever. Now, to be fair, a lot of the shit in 50 Shades of Grey, I will admit, is kind of abusive and is really not at all what
it's creepy.
Is actually like. Yeah, and that's one of the reasons, that's one of the big things a lot of people who are into the lifestyle or really hate about 50 Shades, because we now have people showing up and girls going, I have no limits. And I'm like, do you realize how much danger you just put yourself in by saying that? There are some seriously sick motherfuckers in the community, I will say that. It's like, look, if you say you have no limits and then you meet and then you decide you, you want a certain guy to be your master, he can tell you to eat your own shit. If you sign that contract, there's nothing you can do. You cannot say no.
Okay, not to be an asshole towards people who live in the southern parts of the United States, but there was a story that popped up on BuzzFeed. It was kind of interesting.
Oh, I heard.
Yeah, there was a story where a guy brought a raccoon to a S&M thing.
Yeah.
What that involves, I don't know, and I don't know.
I don't see what happens. I don't see what
happens. Bestiality.
Someone mentioned that on FetLife, and just the main reaction from everyone was like a combination of ew and oh my god, is this serious?
But here's the punchline. The raccoon actually escaped. He got the fuck out of there.
Yeah, I don't see how that has to do anything with the South or in the fact that it's BuzzFeed also. So,
yeah.
I would take it with a grain of salt.
But well, no, I mean, I actually did hear that story on FetLife too, so it actually did happen, but I didn't hear the whole thing. I just heard, hey, this
They also say that the person in New Orleans that got that started a SWAT thing with some guy on Twitch was arrested, and that was mainstream news, even though it never happened.
Can we all agree that Florida is fucking crazy?
Oh, yeah,
hey,
definitely.
Hey, we were saying this last night. Hey, Spain, it's America. Look, I know you haven't really had a bunch of countries other than when you own... than your own here for a couple hundred years, but do you want Florida back?
I already been to Florida. It's okay now. It's not that
I lived
bad.
In Florida for a little while, but...
But how come every crazy... I mean, given how global the world has become and how quickly news stories spread on all over the world, every time I hear about some crazy, insane story, some ludicrous story, it's always Florida.
And every time you hear a sick feminist, it's from San Francisco.
Yeah.
Go to at Florida, man. You see all those crazy
The craziness
stories.
Is Florida in Florida is probably because my mom lives there, and I don't know about San Francisco.
Oh.
Bay Area hipsters. Long story. You would have hated that place.
All I gotta say, I went to San Diego, and I don't want to go back there.
Ooh, San Diego? Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah? How did you survive?
I told Teacup because she actually lives
in the area. I swallowed my pride.
Well, doesn't Teacup live in the valley?
But she lives near there, and I found that out when we were reacting into the room. And it's like I told her, look, if I'm ever in that area and I want to hang out, we are not hanging out in San Fran. We are going somewhere else.
My brother has recently moved to the USA for a few months because he started working for a company there, and they're in San Francisco, and he met his first real serious girlfriend in like 10 years, and he wants to bring her home on Christmas, and I'm really worried that he might have fallen because he's kind of like an Apple
fallen.
User.
I bet you know she when she comes through the door there's the pink mohawk and the piercings.
No, I saw her in a picture. She's just normal blonde long hair, but still,
oh my
the
gosh.
Crazy can hide within.
I want to share this with you because this was just in the chat, and I think this is one of the best ideas I've seen mentioned in any stream chat. Dragoon says, "Dude, let's sell California to Russia. I am all for that idea."
Hey man, I like
Why
California.
Would they buy that?
Yeah,
California.
We could just give it to them.
No, they wouldn't take it. They would just take the receipt, the gift coupon, and return it at the store.
As long as we don't get it back, I don't give a fuck what they do with it.
You could give it to Mexico.
You know
I think Mexico is invading. If you, oh, that's why Donald Trump wants to build the wall.
Yeah.
like
he said, a regular wall doesn't work, but a wall made by Donald Trump works.
There's going to be a severe shortage of maids in Orange County after that, of course.
Oh my god.
I love the fact that Donald Trump said if he won the election, he was going to deport all 11 million. Illegal immigrants. Yeah, good luck with that.
Hey,
hey man, you can't stump the Trump.
Yeah.
Every time it takes. Okay, here's a joke. Every time Donald Trump takes a dump, he loses $10 million.
Yeah.
No. Oh man. It's. No, I saw a few people. I can't remember where, but saying something like, "Here's a drinking game during the debates. Take a shot every time Trump mentions, illegal immigrants." And all I could reply with was. But I actually want to live.
Yeah, those evil, scary Mexicans are coming.
I think Donald Trump should team up with Vermin Supreme because they're alike, but they can actually pool their votes. Because Vermin Supreme gets the votes of the people who elect joke, who vote for joke candidates on purpose, and Donald Trump gets the.
He's nuts.
Yeah.
But seriously, let's say that he wins the nomination for the Republican Party. Who the hell is going to be his vice presidential candidate?
That's what I want to bring.
Oh my god. Like I said, I said this to James a while back. I can't, you know, what if he does become president and he has to fire a member of his cabinet? Will he do the "you're fired" hand motion? Cuz god, I want to see that shit.
He'll probably have that shit on reality TV. He'll do it. He's that kind of guy.
Yeah, I could see him doing that, actually. You're absolutely right.
At least 4 years of complete and utter hilarity.
Yes.
Yeah, I still don't. Okay, here's my big thing, okay? He has all these billions of dollars, and yet his toupee still looks like a completely different sentient life form that is burying itself into his brain.
Well, I actually think that President Trump could be the first step to President Camacho.
We'd all want an ex-porn star wrestler as president, I think.
You did elect Arnold Schwarzenegger as governor of
the... Hey, we didn't. They did.
Well, here's the crazy part about that. I mean,
I had nothing to do with it.
California is a 60% Hispanic state. They had an Austrian governor. That is weird.
Conservative.
That is hilarious.
Even, it was like... It's like, okay.
Well, let's think of it like this. A 60% Hispanic population probably couldn't read English anyway, so they probably looked at some guys like, oh, that's a Terminator, and they voted for him.
Yeah. Actually, I remember they made a flag.
What's that going?
There's some serious echoing going on in here, guys.
Sorry about that.
Well, anyways, I think it's going to be an interesting, but, you know, if just to piss everybody, I mean, everybody in Gamergate would be pissed off as hell if this happened.
Listen to this.
You know, the wall doesn't work. You ask Israel whether or not a wall works. Believe me, a wall properly done, a Trump wall works.
Trump wall.
My God.
I will build a wall. It will be huge.
I have a question to ask for someone that was in the chat. Why do you think that I'm from Canada? Or why do you think I'm Canadian?
Say about.
I'm from Georgia. Georgia is a state.
Say about. You know, all Georgia you have to do is say about.
State.
Say about, and let's prove
about.
It. There
about.
We go.
About. I don't know what you're talking about.
Georgia is merely pretending to be a state. Oh, fuck you, dude. Hey, we got the World of Coke, dude.
Well, you see, my thing
and
is...
We have the local aquarium, which Tay seemed to enjoy when he was here.
I've been to that aquarium before.
If you've got a fear of peaches, though, do not go, because every road is called Peachtree.
Yes, we have 50 streets with the word Peachtree in them, and that's just in the Metro Atlanta area.
That's because it's a fucking annoying as shit to navigate.
Well, you know what's funny? I've gotten so sick of peaches, I can't eat them anymore because I'm so sick of them.
Well, I'm gonna close the stream down. We can talk off air and shitpost
this is now the official Peaches stream.
Yeah, we're gonna talk shit about
there is actually a country named Georgia. I was just reminded of that. I live in the state Georgia in the U.S., not the country.
All right. Well, thanks everyone for watching. We're gonna continue this off air. So thanks everyone for watching. See ya.
We don't get a show.
I'm
get out of here.